Hi, everyone. Welcome to TechSoup Connect Australia. This is the newly combined TechSoup Australia. I'm Kat Milner of Create Your Change, and I am one of the hosts here at TechSoup Connect Australia. Today, I'm really excited to have Wendy Perry, who is the Managing Director of Workforce Blueprint and an Entrepreneur Facilitator for Adelaide in the West Switch Start Scale. She's an author, entrepreneur, and educator, explorer and innovator, mentor and speaker on entrepreneurship and innovation, workforce planning and development, vocational education and training, and a whole host of other things. In my small business, Create Your Change, I have had the pleasure and the privilege of working with Wendy for a little over a year now, and it has been wonderful to have the kind of support that she provides, the perspective, and in a lot of ways, the out-of-the-box thinking. So I know you're going to get a lot out of it, and I'm so glad you're able to join us today. And without further ado, Wendy Perry.
Thank you, Kat, and hi, everybody. I hope your morning is going well for you. I know that a number of people might to this a little bit later on. And what we're going to really do is hone in on the importance of having an entrepreneurial mindset. Part of this, I guess, could be about the language side of things. You know, there's lots of terms and phrases that are kind of used, and whether or not you identify as an entrepreneur, perhaps you are more of an intrapreneur. You might be working in a not-for-profit or for somebody else, where you're like an entrepreneur for your employer, or maybe you're in that social innovation space. But what we're going to step through today is, a bunch of evidence and reasons and examples why you might want to put more of a kind of like entrepreneurial spin on things. There's also some funding opportunities that I want to kind of share that are current and available to people right now. And we're going to look at a couple of models. But really what we're talking about with that entrepreneurial approach is more like a mindset rather than a label of being an entrepreneur. And in my role as entrepreneurship facilitator, I work with so many different people. I've probably heard just about every business idea that you can think of under the sun over the last couple of years, and that's here in Australia and internationally as well. So I've got some slides that I'm going to share with you. I'll just pull them up. Now, and I've got a couple of screens here, so you might sort of see my eyes flipping across to different areas. But let's sort of get started and, delve into why applying an entrepreneurial mindset is important. And that's regardless of the context that you might be in, you know, the workplace setting, whether you have your own business or you work for somebody else. And I can appreciate that, you know, people listening to this, there's a variety of different backgrounds and perspectives that you might have. Definitely we're seeing many more people, I guess, kind of taking an entrepreneurial approach, or they might chunk it up more as innovation when it comes to things like government policy and programs, regional development agencies, and there is a massive rise of side hustles as well. So probably the impact of COVID, you know, lockdowns, restrictions, has meant that a number of people have really thought, you know, long and hard about the security that they might have in terms of their employment and where they might want to go around bolstering that up and basically giving yourself some options, that's a bit different as opposed to only thinking about working for someone else. Now, I know that we're going to have some not-for-profits interested in this content as well. So one of the key reasons that we sort of talk about having an entrepreneurial mindset is to keep pace with what's happening. And if you'd like to sort of put any comments into the question chat box, feel free. But just before we get onto that, can you let us know in that chat box, what are some of the emerging trends or things that you've kind of noticed more broadly about the economy? Now, let's just say that I think most people are probably in Australia, but if you could put into the question chat box, what are you noticing about the emerging trends around, economic development, social kind of impact, government sort of policy? What are some of those drivers and things that you're kind of seeing? So we're just going to set the scene a little bit and link that to, you know, why it is that we need to have an entrepreneurial approach to things. Certainly, obviously, we're sort of seeing a massive rise in terms of online development. Many more people much more comfortable with that. But let's just run through what sort of happened over this last year or two and what's emerging for 2021, 2022. Yeah, pivoting comes up a lot, doesn't it? So collaboration and pivoting. Now, I don't know about you, but one of the things that was a massive bonus through last year was that when we did have shutdowns, I had to move obviously lots of different face-to-face events, networking and so on to online. But what I found was that reaching out to speakers, I had people speaking that were futurists from Canada, for example. Another guy who's one of the biggest public speaker, you know, kind of coaches from the UK, you know, colleagues from United Nations, the ILO, you know, all of these different kind of groups, the European, you know, Commission, for example. And it was amazing to see their openness and willingness to collaborate and speak online. Normally it cost probably a fair bit of money too, but often people were doing that for free. Now, we are going to delve into the area of that economy and jobs a little bit more because it has a direct link to entrepreneurship in a minute. But the other areas is this notion of entrepreneurship. And we are seeing so many corporates now basically having people in innovation kind of roles and working in things like, you know, international challenges, hackathons. It's becoming, you know, such a strong part of more like a corporate culture as well. But if you're not for profit and perhaps you're a small business or startup, then you've often got kind of like more agility and flexibility. And I think corporates are really becoming much more open to learning what they can. The notion of, you know, who you're collaborating with, who your clients are, where are your markets, you know, has really kind of blown out from local to national and then to international as well. And I can appreciate that some of you might be in more of that kind of program or project, you know, delivery kind of area. And there is lots of funding and opportunities related to different kind of cohorts in our community too. And we've seen lots of significant investment going into mental health awareness. Working at home, I think, I don't know about you if you love it, but I really enjoy it. I think lots of people really enjoy it. But we are seeing some really significant changes around workforce redeployment as well. So one of the reasons that we need to have like an entrepreneurial mindset is because of this kind of situation and environment that we are facing at the moment too. I can see some of the comments. So yeah, traditional businesses, and some of those are corporates, might be government, even some really large private sector organisations aren't always particularly agile either. And that's kind of shown through, hasn't it, over the last year or two. And yeah, the environment, having a healthy space to work in for sure. So just sort of delving down into what's happening around the economy and jobs and why entrepreneurial thinking is really important as part of this. We've seen like a reorganisation of the economy. So we used to think down quite sort of specific, you know, industry kind of silos almost. But if you have a look at what's happened over the last year to 18 months, there's been a real reorganisation. So we've seen jobs and organisations sort of fit more into that essential kind of worker service. You know, it's definitely health. Certainly it's in retail and food and other aspects as well. Then the second area is this enabling sector. So that would be more driven by technology. You know, contact centres, for example, the rise of Zoom, don't we all wish we had shares in that? But heaps of other sort of tech companies have come to the fore there as well. And, you know, scaled up massively in terms of their recruitment. And there has been, in an Australian context anyway, depends upon your experience around lockdowns and your location, but, you know, massive growth workforce numbers-wise and real labour and job skill shortages in that space too. The experience economy, so thinking more tourism, hospitality, those sorts of areas, even, you know, like in South Australia, we love our wine industry, cellar door. That's been, you know, obviously an area that's been hit really hard and needs a lot of support. But then we've definitely seen much more acceptance, adoption, let's say, of an entrepreneurial kind of approach, whether on that that's in your own business or in startups or whatever. And I can see as well, yep, David's making a comment about the role of government assistance to the working poor is enormous in growing first world economies. Yeah, and David, you might want to, you know, put in some of the countries that you've got some experience with. In the, you know, up until last year, we were doing a lot of international work and travel, but countries like Indonesia, you know, the Philippines, you know, it's really interesting to see how they're managing with this too. And sometimes people have no tourists around entrepreneurship either. But an entrepreneurial approach, I mean, what's kind of different about that compared to maybe how you're culturally thinking where you're situated now? Well, most entrepreneurs do have a give first kind of mentality. You know, generally speaking, people are very kind. They are warm. They open up their networks, you know, their experience, their connections. They're constantly learning. You know, they're looking for problems to kind of solve. These are the sorts of traits that we're talking about. And here's some images from a bunch of events and things that we've run over the time. But there is one fundamental model, and some of you might be very familiar with it, that is kind of associated with an entrepreneurial approach or entrepreneurial thinking. Now, you might use other models, so perhaps you want to, you know, put into the question chat box what you think might work for you. But Lean Startup or Lean Canvas, other versions of this business model canvas as well, which is kind of like more sophisticated or next level kind of layer. But when it comes to an entrepreneurial way of thinking, what we try and do here is understand what is the problem that we're trying to solve really, really deeply, and how does that differ to other sorts of thinking. Some other people will start more like with what's the solution that I'm trying to design and who am I trying to serve. But this really hones in on what are those problems that you're trying to solve and who are you trying to solve it for. And, you know, that question is to will people actually pay? So you might want to put into the question chat box, you know, in whatever context you're in, startup, small business, tech company, not-for-profit, whatever it might be, what are the specific problems that you're solving for your clients and customers at the moment? I wear a couple of different hats. So we switch, start, scale. I'm working mostly with people with business ideas, startups and scale-ups. And I've seen thousands of people over the last 2.5 years since the contract began. It's funded by the Australian government, a tender that we were lucky enough to win. And there's so much commonality around the things that people are challenged with. Confidence is a key thing, you know, focus and using your time efficiently. But getting down to sales, like that's always the number one kind of thing, and having that sustainable kind of income. So regardless of marketing and all the other topics that come up, sales is absolutely, absolutely key. So I can see some examples here of technology overwhelm and being able to produce live events, helping people use tech in their business. But just think through, what are those problems that you're solving? And when we're discussing that with our customers and clients, we need to actually go deeper into what the pain of the problem is. So most people will always spin it positively. And, you know, when you're at an event or you're being asked, what do? You know, they sort of focus on the solution side. But a key point of difference here is delving right down into the detail as to what the problem is. You then show your customers and clients that you can be in their shoes, you perhaps have been in the past, and that you've got the answer or some suggestions or some solutions that work to pull that out of it. So you can work through this model. You can do it in, you know, there's some numbers there suggested in terms of the order, but, you know, different people have a different sort of take on things. The understanding the key customers, and sometimes, you know, that could be all sorts of different groups. Like sometimes I'll have people with switched out scale and be like, okay, so who's your target customer? And then, oh, anyone and everybody. I'm like, no, it has to be much more specific. Can we give a profile to who it is that we're actually talking about? The unique value proposition is really important. You know, is this something that can easily be copied or not? And in a minute, we're going to do an activity which is more around your intellectual property. Now, probably the area that I've seen significant change over the last 18 months is revenue streams. So we saw some people just like, I'm not sure if I can continue. We saw some not-for-profits and charity clients in particular hit really hard, particularly where they had a more like a donation kind of model, where that was, that became very challenging to ask, you know, for people to give money and donations when some of those, you know, people were sort of struggling themselves. Massive sort of competition. So a lot of innovation around revenue streams. And the key point here, I guess, is to think through, and we talk about your business model, right? What's your business model? That basically means how you're bringing cash into your organization. And thinking through diversifying that, you know, is it government funding? Is it subscription or membership? Is it fee for service? You know, what are the various ways that you're bringing that funding in? And it's really important to think more broadly, creatively, innovatively, about how could you use that to your advantage, and how could you, you know, think a bit differently about that. Now, what we're going to do now is move into kind of like a system, and it's really related to a scaling up sort of side of things, because that's something that we've seen, well, a lot of people have got an ambition to do. Not that many people necessarily achieve this kind of goal, and most people get confused or they're not sure about what way that they want to go. So if you could put into the question chat box, you know, a bit about the organization that's your main kind of employment or self-employment, you know, what kind of stage are you at? Are you startup? You know, are you thinking about sort of scaling up? Are you working with a mature organization? Just be good to get that kind of sense from you. And we'll work through this five S's when it comes to scaling up. So this is one example of how you can potentially systematize your intellectual property. This is using an alliteration where everything starts with the same letter. And, some people think, oh, systematize means like tech systems and things like this. What we're talking about here is your intellectual property, you know, the tacit knowledge that sits within your brain and the brains of other people that are in your team, making that explicit. So we're sort of using a knowledge management model here, tacit to explicit knowledge. And then when putting it into a package or a way that makes it teachable and saleable and, you know, that people will actually engage in, they can follow really closely. So systematizing the way that you work in your IP is absolutely fundamental and key, particularly if you're in more of a knowledge sort of based area, perhaps a service-based area, you know, again, those programs, those projects, those initiatives. Streamlining what you offer is really important too. You know, we talk about getting traction, and that can be really hard. You know, traction just basically does mean sales and customers and growth and so on, and that sort of is a multiplier effect. But streamlining what you offer can help you get that traction, because if you've kind of like got a menu, you know, it's sort of like when you go maybe to a particular sort of restaurant and they've got like so many things on the menu, it can be really confusing and hard. So if you can hone your energy and your effort into, you know, a couple of things, and when we say scaling up, it might not be that the whole organization is scaled up. It could just be that some of the products or services or experiences are scaled up. Servicing your clients, of course, absolutely critical, and how you kind of have an ongoing relationship, you know, rather than just like a once-off interaction with them. And then, you know, with my workforce planning development hat on, where we do workforce plans, you know, normally 3 to 5 years, sometimes longer window for companies and industry sectors and regions and towns, you know, supporting your team and putting time into capacity and capability development is really important as well. Now, we're going to have a look at a scaling up kind of model. So I'll just have a look at, Bruce, I'm happy that you've got to be able to learn how to spell systematize. So systematizing and learning, people are also in startup kind of mode with an eye to scaling up. So that's really good. I'll just have a look at what else is there. Yeah, and you've made some comments about the sorts of things that you help people with too. All right, so let's have a look at this scaling up model. Now, this is from Vern Harnish. So, you know, guy that was kind of like famous for writing the book. Well, I think I've got it here with me, but the book about scaling up and a particular approach. This is another example of systematizing your intellectual property. This is a four component model, and you can kind of see the chunks, and then obviously he's written his book around that with chapters, turned it into training and development programs, lots of different opportunities. Interesting in this that it puts people kind of first, because you really can't achieve anything without having a strong team. Now, the part about a strategy, this is often, you know, a significant gap. I don't know if anyone here has a strategic plan to follow. And it doesn't mean that we have to have something, you know, so developed in huge amount of detail, but, you know, a picture as to where we want to go to, you know, a vision, a mission, purpose statement, whatever you want to call it, we need to know where we're kind of headed. I mean, that's got to be flexible as well. But this model talks about having a truly differentiated strategy. So point of difference is, you know, something that we discuss all the time. Now, you might want to put into the question chat box, what's your point of difference in terms of your product, services and experiences? This can take a little bit of time to think about. And I guess it's more like at an operational sort of practical level. But here we're talking at a strategic level. And, you know, the model talks about defining your core values and your purpose, who your customer is, and at least looking out a couple of years. So if you're comfortable too, and you can put in there what you think your point of difference is, that'd be really great. The execution. So, you know, that culture of accountability, and it links back to your people as well. Fine tuning out those processes. The sorts of tech and systems and everything else that you're kind of using too. And then obviously this part about the money side. Now, this can be a tricky area. Some people, even though they might even be in business for themselves, don't like to discuss this in too much detail. As an entrepreneurship facilitator, I do often see people with, you know, all sorts of amazing ideas, and it's like, okay, how can we do a budget for this? What does the cost structure kind of look like? You know, what is it going to take to start things up and then sort of keep things going? What kind of forecasted sales? Now, I generally just use a really simple, you know, profit and loss kind of template. But a key area here is that people often underestimate all of their expenses. We have like line by line here as well. And if you wanted to look at this model in a bit more detail, you can have a look online. You can download chapters and things for free. So it's Startup by Vern Harnish. But what I'd like to do now is just delve a little bit into that resourcing and that kind of funding side. I can appreciate that if you're not for profit or you're a relatively new kind of business, then, you know, a key question I get asked all the time is there any grants for, you know, starting up a business? Depends where you are located. If you're in Australia, sometimes councils do have grants, some state and territory governments do, but generally speaking, there's not just kind of like a magic funding. There's funding for certain things. So I'm just going to put the author of Scaling Up, it's Vern Harnish, into chat. Thanks, Kat. And the book is just called Scaling Up and the model. Awesome. So I don't think anyone's been brave enough to put what their point of difference is, but that's a really key thing to kind of understand and then flow that up to what your actual strategy is. So if you could put into the question chat box, you know, what's your kind of business model at the moment? Is it fee-for-service? Is it membership subscription? Is it grants and funding? Is it philanthropic money, donations, bequeathments, whatever it might be? I don't know if I said that wrong. Bequeathment. If you could put that into the question chat box, that'd be really good. And we're just going to touch on some different options in terms of, you know, thinking about that investment, the resources, the cash sort of side of things. Now, I think it's really tricky if you only have one of these. And, yeah, the comments about diversification is really, really important. So you do really have to have kind of like a fee-for-service base. If you then happen to get grants, donations, funding, support or whatever, that's great. But the cycle of constantly going for grants and funding and initiatives and things is ridiculously tiring. And it can be, you know, really wearing on yourself as, you know, somebody leading perhaps or working with a team of people. It's getting incredibly competitive. I think more and more people are thinking about these options as they kind of come up. So I can see I've got, you know, donation, fee-for-service, subscription for sure. So we are going to touch on some of the opportunities around funding and fellowship. And I guess the way to think about some of this is that it's like a massive bonus if you happen to get some of this. Applying an entrepreneurial mindset, though, is thinking about where the opportunities might be and also opening up your mind as to where you actually look. Many times, and I've run webinars before specifically on grants and funding, for example, when many clients, we've helped with them with their applications and whatever, but they just didn't even know that any of this sort of even existed. So I'm just going to run through a couple of key opportunities that are available and open right now. Some of them I'm writing even for our own organisation. And just see how they fit. And you'll see the different kind of locations as to where you could potentially look out for them. And, you know, it's kind of like how can you put an innovative, creative spin on this? Because these opportunities are kind of like broadly shaped already. And whatever it is that you've got that you want to do, you'll have to figure out a way to sort of fit it in. I just want to say a note about fundraising and investment. I don't know if anyone's raised any funds, you know, specifically through capital raise or whatever, let us know. But often people say, oh, I need an investor or I want to get an investor. Okay. And I do have a hat as an investor as well in with myself and my husband and a few of our connections. We invest in early stage startups. But people often think that they need an investor, but they only still have a concept. They don't even necessarily have customers or clients. Now, it would be really rare for investors to, you know, go ahead with something which is just conceptual unless it was something that was so different and innovative and unbelievable, almost, you know, still proven, of course, but that would be incredibly rare. So the point of getting an investor, you know, their values have to match yours, their interests have to match. And, you know, there's that saying, if you ask for money, you'll get advice. If you ask for advice, you'll get money. And often they're quite hidden as well. It's hard to find people who are in that space. A lot of the time it is, high net worth individuals, family trusts. You know, if it's more of a corporate, well, you'll see that sort of stuff publicly out there. But fundraising and investment is massively challenging and relatively rare in an Australian sort of context as well. Now, another thing to think about is who else can you work with where your objectives are going to be similar? So are there some partnerships that you can create? And a note that you want to make here, something that I found works really well, is to do like a partnership kind of map. So if you think of like concentric circles, you put yourself and your organisation at the centre of that, and then, you know, the next layer out, who are you collaborating with and so on. It really helps you think through, okay, who needs to come closer, who maybe needs to move a bit, you know, further out of that inner circle. It's a great visual way of representing to others where those connections and partnerships might be. And then we've touched on subscriptions and memberships as well. So entrepreneurial thinking means that we are opportunity spotting and we're seeing how can some of these things, you know, fit with the sorts of objectives and goals that you have. So a fund that's open available at the moment. Has anyone heard of this, the National Priority Fund? If you have, maybe put this like a yes, no, if you've heard of it or not, into the question chat box. And look, I'm just picking, you know, a real variety of different things at the moment. But with this one, this is more connected to the local employment facilitators. So this is, I guess, an indication from a government point of view as to where their priorities are. This is Australian Federal Government, Department of Education, Skills and Employment. And what's sitting behind this is that there are significant pockets of unemployment. You know, then there's other areas where there's massive labour and skill shortages. This National Priority Fund is really interesting because it's at an expression of interest stage. It actually closes on Monday. There are 51 employment facilitators around the country. So it depends upon, you know, where you might be located. You do need to have a chat with the local employment facilitator if you're going to put in an expression of interest, or at least email exchange a little bit so they know what you're doing. But reading through these guidelines, and I'm working on three or four expressions of interest at the moment, really open in terms of what you might want to do. And it's basically to help people, you know, get back into the workforce. It does cover things like transport, for example, childcare, infrastructure, skills development and training, working on the employer side or with industry sectors, or, for example, if there's a number of people in not-for-profits, you know, you could think down industry lines, or you could think down the types of organisations and what they kind of need in terms of jobs, you know, within their businesses. There's points here about more like workforce retention and succession planning and career development. So a very flexible fund that, you know, you could probably look at for yourself, or coming up with some sort of program for your own organisation. It's a great kind of opportunity, and you can check out that link as well. The next one is more like a fellowship. So the Sydney Meyer Foundation, they've got opportunities open at the moment, innovation kind of fellowships, opportunities for you to tap into more like personal development, education and learning. So you can kind of see that, you know, up to $120,000, you know, there's certain programs attached to that. Sometimes there's flexibility around what you can use that for. So if you're looking to develop yourself in terms of your profile or positioning, maybe thought leadership, then there's lots of opportunities like this that are popping up, you know, that are more, a bit more in that philanthropic sort of field as well. Now, has anyone looked for opportunities outside of Australia or the country that you are in? Can you say yes or no if you've looked at international opportunities? So just pop into the question chat box if that's something that's on your radar, because often, you know, we're looking locally and maybe nationally, but we're not sort of looking beyond that. Interestingly, the United Nations have got an innovation fund, which is up to $100,000 US of equity investment, if you've kind of got solutions that are going to sort of benefit, in this case, this one specifically about children, but the world more broadly. So they are really looking at early seed stage investment. They're looking at emerging technology solutions. And, you know, if it's more like a startup stage, that the sorts of things that they're looking at. They have looked at things like artificial intelligence, data science, blockchain, drones, you know, extended reality, all sorts of things in the past. But I guess what I'm just sort of suggesting to you here is United Nations, you know, ILO, OECD, these kind of really large organisations that have got member countries have got significant funding up often. And I just want to tell you a quick story, which was back in 2018. There was an opportunity advertised by the United Nations, and it was to do an action report and project on entrepreneurial education in Australia. It wasn't Australia specifically, it was in your country. So with Workforce Blueprint, we applied for that. We were the only people in Australia to even put in anything, and we won the opportunity. So that was significant funding that came into the organisation, plus a trip to Bangkok in Thailand and a trip to South Korea to present the work, go along to a conference and to meet with a dozen other countries. Amazing that nobody even had seen it, or that there was no competition, basically, from Australia to sort of put that in. So that was an amazing opportunity. And with that relationship with United Nations, it built upon a previous connection where there was a program, again, that came out of Bonn in Germany, out of United Nations HQ, which has an education focus. This is sort of some of the background. And I contacted the guy who was running this program, which was kind of like a specific industry area, excellent sort of program with leaders from all around the world. And they were looking for some facilitation, got the opportunity to do that for a week in Bonn in Germany with 25 countries and their leaders from those organizations. Unbelievable experience. Made a connection whilst I was there with the head of the European Commission that had that education focus again, a guy that would normally be pretty untouchable, via LinkedIn, humble hustle, we call it. So I guess an entrepreneurial thinking here is to make the most of these opportunities. Caught the train to Brussels, had an amazing lunch with him, and then a partnership grew out of that bizarre and kind of interesting connection. But, that was set up on LinkedIn before, then that opportunity kind of emerged. So with these sort of opportunities, if you basically just looked at United Nations, ILO, labor organization, and OECD, those three, then that'd help you cover off on lots of opportunities. And you can subscribe to their e-news and their update. This is another one that's happening at the moment, which I'm working with a client on too, who has got connections into Africa. So the other sorts of things that get put up, is this challenge or innovation call. Again, there's funding and opportunity attached to this. You can see how it's the 17, UN Sustainable Development Goals are kind of the common ground that's with United Nations as well. So a lot of people are investing time, energy, effort, and money into solving those problems that are attached to the UN Sustainable Development Goals. If you're not yet familiar with those UN goals, then it's certainly something in terms of some homework to check out. A lot of people that are in not-for-profit or, they're more environmentally conscious or for-purpose kind of space, they are often familiar with the goals, but they may not directly link it to their organisation or their business. So with that differentiated strategy that we looked at before, if you can integrate the UN Sustainable Development Goals, this is if it's relevant, then that makes a massive kind of difference. It puts you on a different playing field, let's say. So lots of opportunities connected to that. And then there's things like, innovation challenges like MIT, Massachusetts out of Boston, has worldwide innovation challenges that you can apply for and get funding for. So it's just like, make sure that you're open-minded, that you're sussing out different kind of opportunities, that you do subscribe at least, to the e-newsers, and that you're across what's kind of coming up. Okay, so now we're going to do a really practical activity which takes us back to the importance of systematizing your intellectual property. And I'm just going to give you a couple of examples and then get you to do this for yourself. So what we talk about doing here, and if you've worked with me with Switch Start Scale, we probably would have gone through this, but this is sort of something that builds upon the education experience, the packaging, the marketing, whatever. So if it's just you and you're self-employed, or it's you and your startup or small, medium enterprise, then you need to think about what's in your head. if you've got a team or other people involved, then this might be something you want to start and then take back to the team. Now, you might already have parts of this or some of this in the mix of what you're working on at the moment. So we talk about systematizing that IP. Two examples is take action. That's the system that is the overarching approach for Workforce Blueprint. So originally, this company's 19 years old now, but originally we had a five-step model to doing a workforce plan. And then, you know, we were funded to create tools and templates and, you know, we shared it a lot and it became really kind of like common and a lot of people adopted it, which was great. But then the IP wasn't really uniquely, you know, belonging to the company anymore. And we'd also realised where people get stuck when they're doing that strategic picture. So the five-step model turned into take action, and each letter stands for something. So this is an acronym. The full picture at this time, know what you want, evaluate the gaps, and then with action, we either keep it as one word or we break it down to address the gaps, coaching and mentoring, timelines, inspiration, ongoing review, and next workforce. So I'm hoping that that kind of makes sense in terms of it's like steps. And when we do a workforce plan, we follow those steps. The document follows the whole process. Something different then, so that's an acronym version, is all the S's in switch, start, scale. And then we talk about self-employed, subcontractor, startup, scale up, small, medium enterprise, side hustle, right? So seven S's. So that's an alliteration. Everything's starting with the same letter. The other way that you could represent your intellectual property is in a diagram or a picture. So, for example, that four-part scaling up model, it's still got words on it, but it's kind of like got those four colours that relates to the chapters of the book, it's colour-coded, that sort of thing. So what I'd like you to think about doing, I'm happy for somebody to volunteer, but if you could put into the question chat box, if you consider the overarching thing that you help your customers and clients with, can you brainstorm anything in relation to what we're saying here? Can you represent it as a diagram or a picture? Can you make it into an acronym? Can you make it into an alliteration? And the best way that I find to do this is to just like brainstorm out loud, you know, with somebody else at least to bounce off of. You might have something like this already, as I say, but it might not be represented in one of these three ways. 5 to 9 is the number of components within the system that works best. And sometimes people are like, well, why is it 5 to 9? And even I broke my rule with my take action because it's 10. But hey, we need to make it, you know, nice chunks, easy to digest. Easy to sort of work people through. And Kat has said about unmuting, so this would be really good, Kat, if we could perhaps work through an example for you and your business. Let's see if we can do some brainstorming, and hopefully that sparks some ideas for other people listening as well.
Cool. Happy to do that. I thought it might be easier than going back and forth with the chat.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, people can still put their ideas in the chat.
Oh, absolutely.
We can do a live example. So, Kat, what's the number one thing that you're helping your customers and clients with?
Okay. We can either pick the live events and summits, the virtual events, or the podcasts. I do podcast production and distribution.
Okay. Have you got a preference for what you want to hone in on?
Probably the live events at this point.
Yeah. Okay. Live events. So, what's the actual problem that you're solving for people with the live events? What are they concerned about or worried about?
Okay, so basically it's a technology question where they have to take the time and the energy to learn how to put together an event, often have to learn new programs or even buy, like, for example, video editing software and learn how to use that so that they can then take parts of their summit and or their event and use that in their marketing and be able to snip that out.
Mm-hmm.
So and a lot of technology overwhelm.
Okay. So tech overwhelm is kind of like the chunked up thing, but it's specifically in the context of live events.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. And then what are the sorts of supports or services that you provide?
Okay, so I have a background in event management, and I've learned how to set up an event, all from the registration to how to promote to how to actually operate the event. I facilitate those events so that they don't have to keep an eye on the chat, and I make them aware of things so that all they have to do is focus on their presentation and making that connection with their audience.
Yeah. So I'm not sure what's jumping in your head. Is there anything in relation to a picture or a diagram, an acronym or an alliteration that's coming through for you yet? I've got something in my head.
Because I've been trying to play with that. I hadn't really gone with the idea of the diagram yet. I've been looking at the name of my business, which is Create Your Change, and trying to find an alliteration or anagram or no, whatever. For either create or change, but it's not quite there yet.
Yeah. I mean, Create Your Change is your C sort of going on there. But what sort of came into my mind as you were talking is it is a diagram, and it's almost like the sort of flow of it. Because you said from, you know, planning through to kind of like the full execution, and you said what all the kind of steps are. So I could see a system that is more like a diagram that is like chunking the key parts of it or the key steps of it, and then the detail that's involved in each of those steps. And then clearly that could then turn into more like a checklist tool or something like that. But on one page, you could represent to your customers and clients, okay, you know, I'm helping you with technology overwhelm so that your live events run smoothly, and here's all the different sort of like components.
Yeah.
I think
you have a clear path of how they would achieve those events.
Yeah, and because you've got that overall event management, you know, you are going to be quite logical. It's going to be step by step. Then what you could do in terms of productizing that is think through, okay, there's a full done-for-you solution.
Yeah.
Or say your client is confident maybe with the registration side but not the actual facilitation sort of part of it.
Right.
So, you know, you could use it almost like as a bit of a needs analysis or assessment to then figure out, okay, where does your products and services fit? Where are they comfortable doing it? Doing themselves.
Yep.
Then the other thing is that if you wanted to, you could easily turn that into programs to teach others too. You know.
Right.
So I guess there's another kind of thing in terms of an entrepreneurial way of considering things. And we talk about four for one, right? So we do something once and then we use it at least four times.
Right.
Like we're recording this session, we might turn it into a blog or a podcast, or we might chop it up with social media posts. So, you know, we're always thinking, what can we do? How does that kind of sound in terms of a bit of a starting point anyway, Kat?
I think it sounds great.
Yeah, awesome. Well, if anyone else has got any other ideas as to what's coming into your mind, then feel free to put forward those suggestions. But essentially what we're trying to do is on one page, we start with that overarching concept that you're helping your customers and clients with, the problem really, and flipping it to the solution, the products and services, diagram or picture, acronym so it spells a word, or alliteration is a great way to do it. Then we can, you know, expand that out, map that out, but that'd take some more time to sort of figure out that. But thanks, Kat, for doing that example.
My pleasure.
Now, just in terms of thinking about an entrepreneurial mindset specifically, there are, you know, a number of 21st century capabilities, and it doesn't matter if this is you, you know, your kids, your grandkids, whatever, the different industries that you're in, the locations that you're in around the world, that are absolutely critical for any role, running your business or whatever. And I'm not going to go through all of these in sort of detail. I do just want to hone in on the next slide where we talk about 21st century STEM and entrepreneurship. The thing that I just want to highlight here, and there might be other words that you've heard before, like employability skills or key competencies or whatever. This is more like a contemporary version of that. Communication is always in the mix, of course, but we're not just talking about basic communication. We're talking about being influential, persuasive, being able to pitch, public speak, being able to do that for 30 seconds, a couple of minutes, an hour, you know, online, on a stage, whatever the context might be. And increasingly that cultural and global capability is becoming really, really important too. Having purpose and vision, not just, you know, the notion of, you know, learning all the time, but mastering. So what this is implying is that you need skills depth and you need skills breadth, okay? The 21st century STEM and entrepreneurship, well, this has a natural sort of connection and relationship with new discovery technologies as well. You know, everything from AI, augmented reality and autonomous vehicles, you know, through to UI, user interface, virtual reality, you know, wearable tech. That part of the skills mix could be seen perhaps as more technical, but increasingly, you know, multiple job roles are needing that beyond digital capability into more that 21st century STEM and entrepreneurship. And there are many examples too of where, you know, digital people and digital humans are being introduced. So beyond just, you know, faceless AI or even humanoid robots, but into a digital people concept. So a really excellent example, if that's something that you like to, you know, where's some examples of amazing technology, is a company called Soul Machines. And they have a basis in New Zealand, actually, and the US, but they have digital people working for significant brands now like Westpac and, you know, public safety in New Zealand with police and all that kind of thing. So check that out if that's an area that's of interest to you. Okay, so just sort of like a more final sort of slide to wrap up and some takeaways for you as well about extending your thinking and your experience. Well, how do you actually do that, right? Yes, you can do it in your day-to-day kind of practice because it's about the approach that you take. But there can be quite specific and purposeful activities that you can engage in. So you could go along to entrepreneurial challenges or even create them yourself. So often they're a day, 2 days, maybe 5 days max, where you are uncovering problems, you're developing a minimum viable product as quick as you can. So this is going back to the lean startup model. And the key point of difference with this and traditional business is that, you know, you're doing things in hours and days, not like weeks, months, and years. Okay, so we're really speeding up that kind of cycle. You could think about what's an entrepreneurial or innovative approach to maybe run some of your events and networking opportunities a bit differently. You could think about who you get involved, you know, who you partner with, what speakers you have, the format of it. There's so many different kind of methodologies and approaches that you could use, you know, borrowed from adult learning sort of concepts that you could try out and experiment with. You know, growth hacks or hackathons. So, you know, they're being run all the time on different sort of topics. I'm involved in one coming up on Friday night, which is about aerospace sort of industry. If you're not already connected into your local entrepreneurial ecosystem, that's really important. Now, sometimes they can be a bit hidden below the surface. Depends upon, you know, your location, your city, your town, your country or whatever. But generally speaking, if you find a little hook in, you know, to your local startup groups or whatever, then a whole thing opens up for you as well. And there's, you know, a real point of being around people that do think differently and having some friends and support to do that. And then a very specific example is Startup Weekend. I don't know if anyone's gone through that. But normally it is, you know, a Friday to a Sunday night, random group of people come together, sometimes friends and colleagues or teams are slightly formed, but not normally. People pitch all sorts of ideas. There's a thing called the hustle, which is amazing to watch because people's ideas are normally spread around the room and then they hustle, try and get people on their team and check out their skills and capabilities. If your idea is not popular, it gets dropped. It's harsh, but that's how it works. And then you're on a team generally with people that you don't know in a 54 hours and you get the thing as quick as you or as far as you can get it, often with sales and things like that, a great opportunity or experience. So if you don't already know about these things, you might want to suss them out or create your own. But they are fantastic ways to, you know, see it in action, and, you know, very practical, pragmatic way to apply and extend your entrepreneurial thinking. So hackathon, a question here is a hackathon. So a hackathon is generally, again, over a day or 2 days, sometimes can be a little bit longer. With a hackathon, they're often data-based. So GovHack is a really good example where government agencies open up their data sets and teams form, often it's more tech-based this time, they turn that data into an app or some sort of, you know, insider information. So a practical example was, you know, one where what are all the parks and playgrounds, you know, near you? We've got all data and information about that. Let's hack that data into kind of like an app which does geolocation. And then that's something that could be tested and put out to the public, you know, to find your local playground or, you know, park. So just a really simple kind of example. And Startup Weekend, we do have them in Australia. We have them in lots of locations. They normally come around once every 2 years as well. So great opportunities for you to get involved. Well, Kat, I'll just wrap it up there and see if there's any other questions or comments that people might have or anything that you wanted to clarify. But I guess, why do you need an entrepreneurial mindset? Well, you need it for every job. You definitely need it if you're running your own business or you're involved in not-for-profit space as well. And you need it so that you can spot opportunities and be ahead of others and also open to collaboration.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Wendy. Nice. I just want to invite everyone, if there's any other last minute questions or anything that you have for Wendy, to please drop that in the chat so we can make sure to address those before the end of it. I have to admit, I didn't know quite what to expect today, and I knew it was going to be awesome, and you definitely did not disappoint. So thank you, Wendy. Nice. It has been really educational, really looking at things from another perspective. So I want to thank again, Wendy from Workforce Blueprint and Switch Start Scale for taking the time to meet with us here on TechSoup Connect Australia today. And thank everyone for joining us. And we will see you next month, when we are going to be talking about storytelling hacks for nonprofits and why that can be important. So thank you so much, everyone. And we'll see you next month.
No worries. Thanks, Kat. Appreciate you having me. See you later, everybody.